In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Schuller, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Schuller will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
Is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning.
Good morning.
We are so glad that you're here today. Believe that God has brought you to this place. For all of you watching on television, we think it is no accident that you're watching now. We pray that you would approach this service with an open heart. And let's give a hand to all of those who are watching at home and thank Him for joining us today. We love you guys. Turn around to those who are standing next to you, greet them warmly in the name of the Lord, and say, God loves you, and so do I. Let's pray. Lord, we are so thankful that you love us, that we're not what we do or what we have, not what people say about us, that no matter what, you love us. You hold us, you want us, you care for us. And so, Lord, we have faith, not faith in our good works or in our righteousness, but faith in the works of Jesus and in His righteousness. We're so thankful that by Him we come into your presence. And, Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
In preparation for this morning's message, hear these words from Luke chapter 18. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, "In a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared what people thought. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, 'Grant me justice against my adversary.' For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, 'Even though I don't fear God or care what people think, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually come and attack me.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?'" This is the word of the Lord.
Change can come on tiptoe. Love is where it starts. It resides, often hides deep within our hearts. And just as pebbles make a mountain, raindrops make a sea, one day at a time, change begins with you and me. Ordinary miracles happen all around. Just by giving and receiving comes belonging and believing. Every sun that rises never rose before. Today leads the way different door, and we can all be quiet heroes, living quiet days, walking through the world, changing it in quiet ways. Ordinary miracles, like candles in the dark, each and every one of us. And the walls can tumble, and the mountains can move, the winds and the tides can turn. Ordinary miracles, one for every star. No lightning bolts or claps of thunder, only joy and quiet wonder. Possibilities right before our eyes. See the way a miracle multiplies. Hope can spring eternally, planted and grows. Love is all that's necessary, love in its extraordinary. Yeah.
Wow. So today, I'm just so privileged to have someone who somehow became an instant friend. Today, we have such a great opportunity to hear from Frank Sontag, who has an amazing show on KKLA, The Daily Drive Home, The Intersection of Faith and Reason. Is that what your show's called?
It's called The Frank Sontag Show.
Of course. Why make it complicated? And how many of you listen to Frank, by the way, on the radio here, just as a show of hands, so a bunch of you. And we're just so privileged to have Frank here today. Let's give him a warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank
Frank
you.
Sontag.
Thank you, Bobby.
Bless you. So you're a biker.
Yes.
And I really want to get right away to your amazing story of how you came to know Jesus and become his disciple. And it really begins with a motorcycle accident.
It does. June 17th of 1984, like many young men trying to find themselves, they buy a motorcycle.
Of course.
Which is what I did. And I ventured on the freeway at that time to go to Hollywood Park, which no longer exists, to see a horse run, whose name was Light the Way Home. He ran dead last, so it was...
a bad omen?
Well, I don't know. So riding back in the San Fernando Valley, I had no helmet on at the time. In 84, there were no helmet laws. And I looked in my mirror to make a lane change, and I saw a car barreling up on myself and the woman I was seeing at the time. And California Highway Patrol estimated on impact we were hit at 110 miles an hour. I'm here to say I'm alive, and so I wanted to find out what life was about. So I sold everything I had, moved away for a time, came back to Los Angeles, and ended up on the radio at a music station in town as a spiritual teacher. I fell into the New Age.
This is almost a part of your conversion experience, isn't it? I mean, it didn't lead you right to the cross, but that accident caused you to sort of think about the bigger questions, essentially.
Without a doubt, Bobby. And I spent 21 years teaching New Age principles, which is all about self. It's seductive, it's appealing. It temporarily kind of satiates you, but I still was empty. And so for more than two decades, thousands of people I taught, allegedly, away from God, until a moment on a golf course here in Orange County in 2009, where my best friend and his brother decided to confront me with the gospel.
So you have this best friend and his brother, and they were just like, okay, Frank is this New Age guru. And this isn't long ago. This is 2009, so we're just talking a handful of years ago. I would think that experience is fresh on your heart, and there you were on the golf course, and you had your best friend and his brother, and they just got it in their head they were gonna turn you.
We're on the third hole. I'm about to ready to hit the ball, and Pastor Dale says, who's Jesus Christ? And I stopped. Are you kidding me? We're playing golf. I used to hang up on Christians on my program. I had a resistance to even opening my heart to God because I was in full rebellion, living for myself. So we played for nine holes. We go to lunch, and I found out when we wrote the book and researched it, the night before they made a decision in prayer that they were going to confront me with the gospel because I was out of control in the New Age. So Pastor Dale says to me, and I'd watched my best friend over 3 years after he gave his life to Christ. I watched his life change.
Yeah.
It's undeniable. But they never pushed anything on me, which was important because I knew they loved me at that point. So when Pastor Dale asked me, Frank, if you didn't make it home today, are you right with God? And I instantly said, of course. I'm a spiritual man. I'm a teacher. I'm good. But something in my heart said, too defensive. And so he asked that I would pray in my car, or meditate, as it were. I was a Buddhist, if anything.
Yeah.
And I had never opened a Bible, even though if you listen to my show, Bobby, it would sound like I knew what I was talking about, because I would just slam the Bible, even though I never opened it. But I had no scriptural reference, so I sat in my car, and I began to quiet down, and I heard, are you ready to submit to me? And I knew who it was. Because when the Father who made you speaks to you, you recognize his voice. And so I said yes. And then he said words that forever changed me. I didn't know what it meant at the time. But he said, pick up your cross and follow me. And a few moments went by. Sensation went away. I called my two friends. They're hooping and hollering and praising God. And I said, I want to go to church. I want to go back to church. And so that's kind of where that went. And then on the way home, unbeknownst to me, they had put on Facebook that our good friend gave his life to Jesus Christ.
We're going to get to that in a second, but one of the things I think people don't realize is most of us here take up your cross and follow me, we go, yeah, of course, it's in the Bible. But when you heard those words, you'd never read the Bible, you'd never heard those words before from a scripture. So when you heard the Lord, and I believe it was the Lord, say to you audibly, right? I mean, that was a real, yep. You actually heard God's voice say, take up your cross and follow me.
Yes.
That wasn't like something you'd heard before. It was a new thing for you.
I had no idea. And it actually wasn't until 5 weeks later when Pastor Dale mailed me a Bible that I was up late one night on my knees. My life was kind of falling apart. And Luke opened up to me. And when I read 9:23, and this is what a good Christian I was 5 weeks in, I knew red letters meant Jesus Christ.
It's good. It's a big step.
So when I read, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, pick up his cross daily and follow me, I hit the ground.
I can't imagine.
And I said, it's undeniable. I couldn't make that up in a million years. So I said, Lord, I'm all yours. I don't know what you have in store for me, but as long as you give me breath, I will sing your praises and I will follow you and share with anybody that comes in my path how good you are. And that's where I am today.
There's something about the types of people, I think, that are drawn to a New Age type experience that oftentimes I think get painted as all bad by Christians. But in truth, in many ways, some of the people that are there are seeking, aren't they? They have a, sometimes New Age people have something sort of built into themselves, I think a sensitivity to spiritual things. And because they haven't necessarily seen the light of Christ or experienced him fully, I find that when New Age people become disciples, they tend to have very often a very deep and rich prayer life and a sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. I mean, do you see that too?
I was hungry, Bobby, after my motorcycle crash. I wanted to understand why I survived. I knew I shouldn't have, so I recognized on some level there was a divine hand, but what it drew me into the New Age, other than it was all about me, was trying to find meaning, yes. And so spirituality, I think a lot of folks in the New Age, if they hear the gospel and really take a moment, I think the Holy Spirit can convict any one of us. Look at me. I was 54. I was big, famous, beautiful wife, home that I bought at the height of the market, and then it crashed, lost my home. But there you go, Proverbs 3:5-6. But yeah, I was great by life standards, but yet I was empty. But I was searching, and I know there are a lot of people still steeped in it that are really searching, because I know they didn't know that there's something missing.
I wish we could hear more about, it's an amazing thing that your wife actually finds out that you were converted on Facebook.
Yeah.
And that ended up being a bit of a drama thing.
A little bit. We were New Age lovers and soulmates, and it started about 18 months of my life being turned upside down. But praise God, in July of 2011, she also gave her life to Christ. And our son, who's now 7, we pray every night, and it's just amazing how God redeems.
How's your life different now that you've become a disciple of Jesus?
Well, I took over this radio program a couple of years ago from a dear brother, Frank Pastore, who led his radio ministry for almost a decade in this town. And I sit in that chair every day and pray to the Lord. I'm not equipped, but please show me the way. And it's very humbling to know that a living God is here and wants to touch anyone that opens their heart and says yes to him. And so it's been a crazy, crazy, crazy wonderful ride.
That's amazing. Well, Frank, you're doing amazing things for God, and I just can't wait to see how you continue to develop. I think you have such a deep and rich knowledge and hunger for the scriptures and for how they apply in life. And I can't wait to see, I think you need to start preaching and start doing some of these things too. I can't wait to hear, do you ever preach?
I have been, yes.
Oh, that's great.
I've been invited to a handful of churches.
Well, maybe we'll have you here sometime to preach for us. We'd love it.
Oh, boy.
Okay. And what's the name of your book?
The book is called Light the Way Home, My Incredible Ride from New Age to New Life. And I never thought I would write a book about my dear friend Lee Strobel, who was instrumental in me coming to Christ when I read his book, The Case for Christ. He said, Frank, you have to write your book. And we wrote it, and Lee was gracious enough to write the foreword.
And maybe you're watching at home and you say, you know, I'm spiritual but not religious. You know, I like Jesus as a person. I don't like Christians. I don't like church. I don't like institutional stuff. But maybe you're hearing something that Frank is saying and there's something in you that feels like it's drawing. I want to encourage you to get this book, Light the Way Home by Frank Sontag. Or if you know somebody like that, buy the book for them. And this story, I think, can make a big difference in either your life or the lives of the ones you love. Frank, thank you so much for being here. We
thank
love you,
Bobby.
And appreciate this
thank you, brother.
Opportunity to hear your story.
Thank you.
God bless you.
God bless you all.
As we move into fall and begin preparations for the upcoming holiday season, the Hour of Power and Shepherd's Grove want to also help prepare your hearts and minds for the season of Advent. Today, Pastor Bobby wants to send you the 2015 Advent Devotional, Indescribable Gift, The Surpassing Grace God Has for You. This book is filled with 26 devotionals written by pastors and leaders of Shepherd's Grove and Hour of Power, all designed to help you as you prepare for celebrating the birth of the Savior. Advent is recognized by Christians as a time of expectant waiting, and this devotional has daily scriptures, devotions, and prayers to help you in the 25 days that lead up to Christmas. For your gift of $25, we will send you this 8.5 by 5.5 inch hardback book. In addition, for your gift of $5, we will include our 2014 Advent devotional, Many Mansions, Your Special Place in God's Kingdom. Our prayer is that these two Advent devotionals will help you in your walk with God during this special season of waiting. Call, write, or go online today and request our 2015 Advent devotional, Indescribable Gift, The Surpassing Grace God Has for You. For your gift of $25 and for an additional $5, we'll also send you Many Mansions, Your Special Place in God's Kingdom. Thank you. And remember always, God loves you, and so do we.
Oh,
Message and a great reminder to all of us, there are no orphans. Well, thank you for being here today. We're so glad that you're here with us in the church. You made the right decision to be here. If you're here on accident, if you're looking for St. Callistus and you're thinking, where's the mass, you know? Maybe your girlfriend dragged you to church today. For whatever reason you're here, even if you think you're here on accident, we believe you are here for a reason and God has a word for you. So listen, if God speaks to your heart, listen and take it deep into your soul, and it will bless you. If you're watching on television, we are so glad that you're watching this morning or tonight, some of you, depending on when you're watching. If you're ever in town, we're very, very close to Disneyland, and I'm serious about that. You can almost walk to Disneyland from here. And if you live in Orange County or LA, come on down and worship with us. We have a traditional service at 9:30 and a contemporary service at 11:15. We'd love to meet you, and come on down, and we hope you come sometime. Also, here in Shepherd's Grove, we love cell phones. If you see someone with a cell phone in their hand, that's a very good thing. The only thing we get upset about is that when you take a picture and post it on Instagram, that you didn't hashtag Shepherd's Grove, you know, or you spelled my name with one L, you know. So we want you to know that this is the place to use your cell phones, take pictures, use it to read your Bible. And I love Twitter. If you're watching on TV, I always respond to everyone on Twitter at least once. All right. Now, today we are continuing a series on my new book called Happiness According to Jesus, which is basically a book about how the Sermon on the Mount, the wisdom of Jesus, is the thing that can bring us into the full, rich life that we all desperately want. Before we get into that, though, let us stand together, and we're going to say this confession. You hold your hands out like this as a sign of receiving. Say this with me. I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Thanks. You can be seated. How many of you have started saying that in your daily lives? Anybody? I start hearing people saying, you know, I was hurried and worried, and I started saying that prayer. Well, that's very cool. Today, we're going to talk about prayer in this theme about what it means to live like Jesus. You know, God wants to talk to you. Because God loves you, and because you're God's kids, God wants to talk to you right now. He wants to hear from you. Very often when we think of prayer, we think of a list of things that we need to go through, things we need to ask God for. It almost becomes like an errand or like going to the gym. We know it'd be really good for us if we prayed through these 9 things, but somehow it's sort of hard to find the time. One of the biggest mistakes that we make in our view of prayer is that we see it only as asking God for things rather than an ongoing conversation we have with God. And so if I can get anything across to you today, it is this, that prayer is a conversation between you and God. The only middleman you need is Jesus Christ. You don't need any gurus, any spiritual leaders. All you need is Jesus, and you can talk to God with power. And I want to get across to you that the prayers that you have change things. That prayer makes a difference in our world, and that God commands us to pray and live a life of prayer. And so my dream is that everyone in this church, everyone in television, gets a vision for a prayer life that isn't something that begins and ends when I need something, but rather, like breathing, is an ongoing thing that I am doing with God in every aspect of my life. For the soul, prayer is like oxygen. Prayer is like oxygen. Many of us are trying to run the race without breathing. How many of you feel like your soul is withered, or you're struggling, or you have doubts, or you just don't have enough energy to carry on another day in your discipleship? How is your prayer life? You see, prayer is the thing that gives us energy in our soul to live like Jesus. Prayer is oxygen. Many of us, especially if you're watching on TV, many people think, I don't know how to pray. Like, I don't know, you know, all the right things to say and all the right things to do. Let me tell you something. You know how to pray. God has built it into every single human heart, an ability to pray, to talk to Him, and to hear Him. It is a soul instinct. It's an instinct. Just like a newborn babe knows how to nurse from its mother, which, by the way, is an incredible miracle. Just as the baby is born, instantly it knows how to nurse. Nobody teaches it. Just as a spider, for example, knows how to build a web. Nobody teaches a young baby spider how to build a perfect, beautiful web, right? So does your soul instinctively know how to pray. I think all of us have built within us the knowledge of how to pray until the point when religious leaders tell us we're doing it wrong. You know how to pray. It is built within you. In fact, I think one of the reasons there are so many religions in the world is that people are born with this sense, this connection to God, but they want to put some rules around it and some understanding around it. And so religion emerges, I think, in many ways as an explanation for this inward knowledge of how to pray. I feel this connection with God, but what is God? What is this thing that I'm connected to? That is your innate need and ability to pray. You know how to pray. And so if we want to live like Jesus, if we want to lead like Jesus and heal like Jesus, if we want to talk like Jesus and trust like Jesus, we need to learn how to pray like Jesus. We need to learn to pray like Jesus. And Jesus prays differently than most Christian leaders today, I think. Now that is not a diss, it's a challenge. It's a challenge that maybe the way we're praying is wrong in the sense that it has become over-ritualized and less personal. We have moved from having a conversation with a God who loves us, a conversation with Dad, to this highly ritualized, overly structured, rote tradition that in public circles is nice, it's good, but sometimes that has replaced the inward, ongoing breathing of life, which is prayer. Jesus, if we want to pray like Him, we have to recognize that Jesus needed prayer. Now, Jesus is the Son of God. If Jesus needs prayer and He's perfect, I need prayer. So do you. We can't survive spiritually without a life of prayer. You find that Jesus he's always going out, the scriptures say, to lonely places and fasting. And there's this ongoing sort of prayer life between Jesus. And the relationship that Jesus has, his prayer life, the way that he prays is so different than the leaders of his day. Jesus doesn't seem to care about wearing the right thing on his head and the thing around his wrists and pointing in the right direction and saying all the right things first. He just sort of, as he's talking to someone, interrupts and says, "Hey, Father." Right? Jesus seems to already be in conversation with God. In other words, for Jesus, prayer never begins or ends. It's always ongoing, like breathing. He is in constant communion with God's love and God's voice. I want that, don't you? I want that so bad. And so do the disciples. And you know what the disciples said? They said, "Lord, teach us how to pray. We want to pray like you." And you know how Jesus responds? He doesn't say what they think he's going to say. He doesn't say, "Well, first you got to do this. First you got to get all the things right in your life. First you got to confess your sin. Or first you have to have all the right theology. Or first you have to read the Bible from beginning to end. Or first you have to do this or that." No, he just says, begin the prayer like this. "Our Dad." I like to say it that way because that's how shocking it was for the disciples. He doesn't say God. Do you know that? He doesn't say Yahweh or Lord. He says Dad. Hey, Dad, that's how you begin your prayer? You can do a whole sermon on just that first line that he says, Our Father. It was like getting splashed in the face with cold water to the religious elite. That it's our Father, that all of us are God's kids, and that prayer is simply talking with Dad? Absolutely. See, this is one of the great revelations about Jesus' teaching is how we pray. That when we pray, we're talking to Dad. He says, Our Father, who's in heaven, bring heaven to earth. We want to see earth in Los Angeles and Orange County right now. We want your will done in here. And give us what we need today, our daily bread, you know. Give us our basic needs and lead us away from a sinful life. And that's pretty much it. And although we pray the Lord's Prayer, and it's good to pray the Lord's Prayer, and it's a part of our liturgy, we want to be careful to not assume that Jesus is saying, pray in these exact words, but rather pray kind of like this. Pray simply and honestly. You see, I think Jesus was attacking the holy hierarchy of his day. Jesus was attacking the holy hierarchy of his day. And today, Jesus is still attacking that hierarchy. It's a hierarchy that says God cares more about his prayers or her prayers more than your prayers. That they're a little bit more his kids than you are. That is a lie. You are God's kids. God can't wait to talk to you. God can't wait to hear your voice. You say, well, I don't know what to say. Just say what's on your heart. You say, well, I have people all the time that are so worried about prayer. They say, I got this question all the time. Do I pray to Jesus or God? Well, Jesus is God, first of all, but whether you pray to the Father or Lord or whatever it is you say, it doesn't matter, guys. Guys, listen to me. It doesn't matter. God sees your heart. You don't even have to speak to pray. You can think pray if you really want. Just you need to express to God and invite God into your living. And see, very often in Jesus' day, he said, don't be like the hypocrites who stand in the synagogues and the street corners to be seen by men. They're getting their reward. And there are still many religious leaders that do this today. That they always say, well, you got to do this and you got to do that to pray perfectly. You got to say this. There is no support for that, I think, in Scripture at all. Scripture simply says that, yes, it says that a prayer of a righteous man avails much, but guess what? In the new gospel, in the gospel according to Jesus, you are righteous not based on your good works, but on the good works of Christ. Did you catch that? You're completely forgiven and justified. There is no amount of good deeds or bad deeds that is going to change the way that God hears your prayer. If you pray, it will avail, because God loves you, because God wants to hear from you, because you're God's kids. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
There is no holy hierarchy. Guess what? God does hear the prayers of the Pope. God hears the prayers of Billy Graham. God hears the prayers of Don Nguyen, but because God hears all of your prayers the same. Did you catch that? God hears your prayer just as much as he hears Billy Graham's. That is so important that we understand that no matter who we are, God values you. Not for what you've done, not for your accomplishments, not for your holiness. There is no special anointing that makes your prayers more powerful than somebody else's prayers. If you believe in God and if you pray in the name of Jesus, your prayers have the same power as Jesus himself praying. That is the gospel. And that is good news. Your prayers have power. Pray! The biggest problem is that we don't have the sense that God is Dad. Am I right? That's probably the biggest issue. We don't see God as Dad, and especially God as Dad who loves us and cares for us and wants to be with us. You say, all right, Bobby, I pray, but why hasn't God answered my prayer? First of all, I want you to always change that sentence by adding one word on the end of that. You ready? That word, and I think it was Frank Fried that said this, was add that one word is yet. Why has God not answered my prayers yet? You see, change the way you think about prayer as something you're hopeful for, something you're anticipating, something that you're approaching in faith. The scripture reading today was from the Gospel of Luke. And in the story, Jesus tells a parable about this rotten judge. It says, there was a judge and he didn't care about people and he didn't fear God and he didn't care about doing the right thing. He was just this wicked judge. And there was this widow who was pleading with this judge for justice. She'd go before him and she would say, give me justice. I need justice. Give me justice. And he kept saying, no, get away from me. This is not exactly how it reads. I'm going to be honest with you. It's something like this. No, get away from me. Leave me alone. And finally, it says, this wicked, evil judge gave this woman what she deserved to just get her off his case. Jesus says, if that's the way a wicked judge will respond to this woman, how much more will your Father in heaven respond to you if you pray like this? And the scriptures say that Jesus told them this parable that they would always pray and never give up. That they would always pray and never give up. Always pray and never give up. Never give up your miracle. Never give up your tomorrow. Never give up your hope. You are not out of possibilities because you have a straight connection, a line to God the Father who can change matter. He can change everything in your life. You have a line to Him. Never give up. Never stop praying because you have a powerful God, and what an ally He is. God is faithful. God is good, and your prayers are powerful. You still say, you know, but I've been praying, and what about all those times when this happened and that happened? You know, honestly, there is a lot of mystery around some of the unanswered prayers that we experience in life. I believe, though, that because God is all-powerful and God is all-loving, there will come a day when you look back at that and understand. For now, though, we have to live in trust. We have to honestly shrug our spiritual shoulders sometimes and say, I don't know. We have to just trust the Lord is good and faithful and never stop praying, because Jesus taught us to pray. It could be, you know, that perhaps some of you are praying and God hasn't answered your prayer because He wants to give you more than you're praying for. Some of you are praying, but you think that your prayers are about ritual or doing the right thing. Friends, just talk to God. Just talk to Him. If you've never prayed before, pray today for the first time. And watch as you, it's like breathing oxygen for your soul. The person who prays for the first time in a long time is like someone who's been with their head underwater and finally comes out of the water and takes a deep gulp of breath. Prayer is oxygen. May your prayer life be like breathing, where throughout all of your life, you continue to talk in conversation with God. Prayer is the thing that gives Christians true hope. Because in a world that where many people don't have a God to look to, they run out of possibilities, they truly feel that they're out of options. But for Christians, the prayer life reminds us that there's always one more possibility. There's always another option. Prayer is the thing that will give your soul hope. Don't give up hope. Don't give up hope. Keep praying and never stop. You know, as we continue to pray for these particular petitions in our life, we'll find ourselves just praying throughout life. The more you pray, the more you find yourself sort of naturally just doing it all the time, where you're praying when you're in the shower. You're praying when you're in the car. You're praying when you're paying your bills. Some of you can even begin to pray when you're sleeping. What an amazing thought. You know, prayer can be something that you always do and never stop, so that when you pray with others, you haven't begun to pray. Rather, you're inviting people to enter into the prayer life that you already have. You're inviting people to breathe with you. See, that is what prayer is supposed to be. It's supposed to be something that never stops, an ongoing conversation and an understanding that God is here, that He loves me, and that He's doing life with me. God has put pastors and teachers and religious leaders in this world, and the world needs them, but they're supposed to walk alongside you. They're not supposed to be in between you and God. They're supposed to walk alongside you. And so you'll find that if you continue to just pray as your day goes on, many of these things that you're worried about, as you pray day after day after day, your soul will change and begin to be trained. And those burdens that you're carrying on your back, whether it's about your worth or your sin or something you're afraid of about tomorrow or fear of your boss or of your job or whatever it is that you're worried about, that you're struggling with, as you pray with those things, you'll actually find that those stones that are in that backpack, that weight that you're carrying around, just seem to get lighter and lighter. And eventually, those worries, those burdens, they'll be like balloons in your hand. You know, you're just like barely carrying them around, and they just want to flee away. And someday, it'll just be like, you know? That is what the prayer life does. Prayer life is the great source of peace, hope, and joy in Christian discipleship. Prayer is the thing that turns our burdens into balloons. Can I get an amen? Amen. There's something powerful about prayer that moves us from a life of hurry and worry to a life of trust. A life of slow breathing, slow walking, an intelligent life in which we're not worried and compulsive, but we are centered in the love and power of God. That's what I want for you guys so much. Oh, I want people to know that power. It's an amazing experience to be living in that kind of prayer life. Prayer isn't something like a chore that you do. It is just the water you swim in. Many of us, when we feel worried or feel stressed, we enter into types of compulsive behavior. Many of us, we have these when we feel stressed or worried or hurried. We find ourselves compulsively reaching for things without intention. So you reach for booze, and you didn't feel thirsty, you didn't want to drink, but you just reach for the whiskey, or you reach for the cell phone, or you reach for the TV remote control, or you're always reaching for other things, some of them bad for you, others of them not bad for you, except they become a part of compulsive patterns in which, in order to not feel worried and stressed when there's a moment of peace in my life, I reach for something to fill that void. I reach for noise. I reach for distraction. I reach for friends. I reach for other experiences so I don't have to experience peace and silence. Because in that peace and silence, I'm going to feel worried and stressed. What would happen if instead of reaching for that bottle of whiskey, you reached for the Lord? Or instead of reaching for that remote control, you reached for the Lord? Or instead of reaching for that cell phone to check your email, you reached for the Lord? What would happen with every gap in our life if we thought, this is another moment to just thank God for today and just take 5 seconds, 10 seconds, to just share with the Lord, even quietly in your own mind or in your heart, to just share with Him, you know, what you're going through. You'd see as prayer would begin to weave itself into every aspect in your life, and you would no longer desire many of those things that you compulsively we're reaching for. People are changed when people enter into a life of prayer. And I want to just end with this last thought. Listening is prayer too. If all you do is listen to God and never say a thing, that's prayer too. In fact, that kind of praying is very often the kind of prayer that is most helpful in our lives. Sometimes it's hard to listen to God because He tells us things we don't want to hear. And so we keep praying. Maybe we'll change God's mind instead of God changing our mind. Listening is prayer too. I remember one of the first churches I was involved with, Willie George, there was this legend. I don't know if it was true. But I remember when I was 16 hearing that Willie George would pray 3 hours every day. I thought, what on earth? How could you have 3 hours of stuff to say? Right? It just sounded exhausting to me. I mean, it's like, what? Who would want to do that? Well, in truth, I didn't understand prayer. I didn't understand that you could sit quietly in a room for 3 hours, and if your mind and heart are fixed on God and on His love and on His power and on His word for your life, you don't have to say a thing. And you can leave that time feeling energized, restored, and renewed. Friends, God wants to talk to you today. God wants to talk to you. Prayer is like oxygen for your soul. Prayer is like breathing. And if you stopped praying, you stopped breathing. You need to be in connection with God. If you're struggling, if you're going through suffering, God is suffering for you. Bring it to Him in prayer and don't stop. Always keep praying. Keep bringing your petitions before Him and listen to Him. He will give you opportunities and answers in your life, and He will move and make a difference in your reality. So let's enter into prayer even now. Would you close your eyes with me? And maybe today, just the body's so important in the way that we pray. Maybe just hold your hands out like this, kind of, however it feels, you know, just small like that. And just watch, it kind of like is a sign of opening your heart to God. And first, I want to just invite everyone who's here and everyone watching on television. Do you know the Lord? Maybe there's a part of you that hungers to know God and become a Christian. Today is an awesome day to become a Christian. And all of you, I want to encourage you in this very moment to search your heart. And if there's just a part of you that believes, maybe the majority of your heart is totally doubtful. You don't know if there's a God or about religion, or you've been burned by religion. There's this part of you that says, I believe in God. If only 1% of you believes in God, that's all you need. Jesus said, all you need is the faith of a mustard seed. And if you can trust that part of your heart to God, He will save it for eternity. And so friends, whether you're a believer or not, I'm going to pray this prayer. And this is a prayer of becoming a Christian. Would you say it with me? Father in heaven, I believe and trust in You. Forgive me of my sin. Renew my heart. And save me. I cannot save myself. I want to become a student of Jesus and follow Him all the days of my life. Fill me with Your Holy Spirit and teach me how to pray. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Thank you, friends, for coming today. I pray that you have an awesome week. Remember, 90% of unchurched people said they would go to church if their friends invited them. I will remind you that 9 out of your 10 friends that don't go to church don't go because you haven't invited them. All right? Thank you, everyone, for coming. I pray that you leave feeling refreshed, renewed, and restored. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift His countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
As we move into fall and begin preparations for the upcoming holiday season, the Hour of Power and Shepherd's Grove want to also help prepare your hearts and minds for the season of Advent. Today, Pastor Bobby wants to send you the 2015 Advent Devotional, Indescribable Gift, The Surpassing Grace God Has for You. This book is filled with 26 devotionals written by pastors and leaders of Shepherd's Grove and Hour of Power, all designed to help you as you prepare for celebrating the birth of the Savior. Advent is recognized by Christians as a time of expectant waiting, and this devotional has daily scriptures, devotions, and prayers to help you in the 25 days that lead up to Christmas. For your gift of $25, we will send you this 8.5 by 5.5 inch hardback book. In addition, for your gift of $5, we will include our 2014 Advent devotional, Many Mansions, Your Special Place in God's Kingdom. Our prayer is that these two Advent devotionals will help you in your walk with God during this special season of waiting. Call, write, or go online today and request our 2015 Advent devotional, Indescribable Gift, The Surpassing Grace God Has for You. For your gift of $25 and for an additional $5, we'll also send you Many Mansions, Your Special Place in God's Kingdom. Thank you. And remember always, God loves you, and so do we.
Join us again next week as Pastor Bobby Schuller brings you a message of hope on the Hour of Power. And when you visit our website, you'll discover books, devotionals, and other resources to take your Christian life to a new level. And Pastor Bobby would love to hear from you. Just write us. And when you do, consider supporting this incredible ministry on a regular monthly basis. We're taking a life-changing message literally around the world. And your regular financial support makes all the difference. Until next week, remember to let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future.